Well, good evening, First Assembly of God. It's so good to be with you once again, in spite of the fact that we are separated by time and space. But nonetheless, the word of God is powerful, and the Spirit of the Lord is still operating in each of our lives. And we're going to gather together here in just a moment to study His Word, a teaching that I think will help all of us. For some, it may be a refresher, a reminder. For others, maybe this is something new. But we will certainly be encouraged and strengthened as we go about the task that God has given us to be priests unto God. We'll come back to that thought in just a moment. But before we get into our study, I do want to remind you, make you aware of some things. Number one, as you can see, the church has not closed. The doors of the church are open. God's people continue to be salt and light. The mission and the mandate of the church has not changed. We are still about the business of making disciples of all nations. We're just having for a season to go about it in a different way, and we are, with the help of the Lord, continuing to do that. So I want to remind you of the many, many opportunities that you have to join together with our church family right here through these means of Facebook or YouTube and share together and be encouraged together. Number one, we've been having a noon prayer meeting, and it has been powerful. Time of intercession, crying out to God. Thank you to those who have been faithful every day, Monday through Friday at noon. We gather together. If you've not joined us, I encourage you to do so. That is through Facebook, the Dallas First Assembly of God Facebook page. And then, of course, we are stepping out in faith and doing something that might seem a little crazy to people, especially during the time that we're in. But I just felt that this is the opportunity. This is the time to do it. We're not going to step back. We're going to step forward. And we are having a revival this week. We're having a virtual revival, but it is going to be as real and as powerful as your faith makes it. And evangelist Chris Clock is going to be joining us Friday night, 7 o'clock, Good Friday service right here on Facebook Live and also on YouTube. We're going to have a healing service, and our evangelist is going to be ministering the Word of God, encouraging your faith, and then we're going to be praying. We're praying from now, we're going to pray then, that God will heal broken bodies. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is still a miracle-working God. He is still a God who is able to touch and heal us spirit, soul, and body. And so we're going to be praying and believing for that. Then to continue Saturday at 7 o'clock, you say, Saturday, what else is there to do? And even if there were, I can think of nothing better than to be under the ministry of the Word of God. And so Saturday at 7 o'clock, gather your family together in your living room. Let's have church. Let's have revival. Let's get in the Word. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to minister to us, and He will. And so we're having a 7 o'clock Saturday night revival service. And then Sunday morning, listen closely, we're going to have a great communion service, celebrating and proclaiming the resurrection of Jesus, fellowshipping together not only in the Spirit, but also having communion together, the Lord's Supper, one of the ordinances of our church. And here's how we're going to do it. You have two options. You can come by the church building on Friday and drive up to the front, and we will take the pre-sealed elements to you that you can take home and hold them for Sunday morning, and we will be here throughout the day. Or if you have your own elements at home, bread and juice, whatever you are, whatever you have, God will see the heart, and you just want to do that and participate. But we're going to have a communion service, and we'll lead you in communion Saturday morning at 10:30 in our resurrection service. And then to close out that great weekend, this great weekend, Sunday night at 7 o'clock, our evangelist Chris Clock will be once again ministering, and we're believing that the Spirit of God will fill every home, that every living room will become an altar, and that the power of God will fall in powerful ways, and that we'll experience His glory like we've never experienced it before. Some people are saying the church will survive. I reject that. The church is not about surviving. The church is about thriving. The church is not just going to, we don't want survival. We want revival during these days. And we believe that God will give it to us if we have the faith to believe it. And we are committed enough to set aside this time to seek His face and to allow Him to minister to us. So a lot of opportunities there, and I want to encourage you. I want to implore you to avail yourself of them, and don't miss what God can do in your life and in your family. It is an investment that you will not regret, I can assure you. All right, let's jump into the Word of God today. I have a study that I pray will be a blessing to you. It is a blessing to me as I was reviewing and studying and allowing God to speak to me powerfully through His Word. Last week we established the fact in our Bible study that God has given all of us as believers a priestly ministry. And we saw that the role of the priest is that of an intercessor. The role of a priest, and we have that wonderful, wonderful visual, not only in the Old Testament worship and the tabernacle and temple worship, but also all the way to the book of the Revelation. We have that wonderful, wonderful description, that wonderful, wonderful example of the priestly ministry of the believer, that you have the altar and the incense. The priest had to keep the fire burning, and they day and night were pouring incense upon the altar, and the incense rose to God as a sweet-smelling savor. And the Bible tells us that the incense that is being poured out upon the altar in heaven is the prayer of the saints. And so that is our ministry, a priestly ministry that we have all been given. And today I want to share with you, to be powerful in your priestly ministry of intercessory prayer, we must know what we have been given, and we must learn how to operate in that priestly office. I have this very, very deep conviction in my heart. You've probably heard me say this before, but it is a deep conviction that I think you will be able to see and understand. And that is that God never calls us to do something that He doesn't provide us what we need in order to do it. And God doesn't call us to do easy things. God doesn't even call us to do hard things. God calls His people to do the impossible. You say, well, how can we do the impossible? It is by definition impossible. But God always makes provision. Listen to me. God always makes provision, and He equips us and gives us what we need in order to do what He has called us to do. And God has called us to be watchmen. God has called us to be priests unto God. God has called us to be the intercessors that will make a difference. And for that task, God has equipped us. God has thoroughly equipped us to walk in victory. God has provided for you and for me everything that we need to do what He has called us to do. Everything that we need. So none of us can point a finger of accusation to God and say, Lord, how could you expect me to do thus and such when I don't have the ability to do it? Because the Lord makes provision. You can think back upon Moses when he argued with the Lord. And for every reason Moses gave to God why he couldn't do it, God made provision for him in order so that he could do it. And that's the same for us. Our God is a just God. And He has called us to do the impossible. And He has given us supernatural strength. He has given us what we need, resources, and we could even call them weapons that God has supplied so that we will be effective in our calling. So we want to learn how to use all the resources and learn how to operate in all of the weapons of our warfare that God has supplied. So very simply today, when we talk about our ministry of prayer, our priestly ministry, what are some of the weapons? What are some of the resources that God has supplied so that you can be effective in your prayer life? Number one, very simple, God has given us the Word. We can pray the Word, and that is very, very powerful. Learning to pray begins with learning the Word of God. And in order to pray with confidence and to pray with boldness, you need to learn the Word of God. I hear people sometimes pray, and I understand the heart of this because we certainly want to pray in agreement with what God wants. But sometimes it's not so much that we are wanting to make sure that we're in agreement. It's that we're not sure what God wants. And so it goes like this. And people will pray, Lord, if it be your will. Well, I understand that. And there are times that certainly we need to seek the will of God. But let me tell you something. His will can be known. In fact, His will has been revealed to us in His Word. So when you know the Word, you don't pray with timidity. You don't pray with uncertainty or doubt or saying, well, you know, I don't know if this is right or wrong. I don't know if God wants me to have this or do this or what God wants. I don't know what His will is. So you say, well, Lord, if it be your will, because we don't know what His will is. When you know the will of God as revealed to us in the Bible, you pray with greater confidence because you know what it is that God wants to do in our lives. I remember growing up hearing one of my pastors say that we were to have three Bibles. I remember my grandmother, how many Bibles do people have today? I got a new Bible. I've been showing this off. I'm so thankful for it. My wife gave me a new Bible for our 17th wedding anniversary, and I needed it because, as I told some of you, my other Bible was defective. You won't believe this. I don't understand it scientifically. Maybe Dr. Larry Wilson out there can explain it. But, you know, with the cold and the hot and the different things, the chemical reaction, the paper and the ink, the letters began to shrink. Can you believe that? The letters began to shrink. And so my wife got me another Bible. Hopefully that won't happen with this one, because I think it's a better quality one. And so hopefully that won't happen with this one. But the letters were beginning to shrink and I was having trouble reading it. But here we are, the Word of God. How many Bibles do we have? A number of Bibles. How many Bibles do you have? Well, I remember one of my childhood pastors telling us, and I remember my grandmother really, really catching this, and she'd repeat it, that we're to have three Bibles. You need three Bibles. Number one, you need a Bible in your hand. A Bible in your hand. And I've got a Bible right here in my hand. I hope and pray that you have a Bible in your hand. The Word of God is powerful, whether it's in book form or in your device on your phone. Hey, the Word of God is powerful. Ink and paper is not powerful. The Word of God is powerful in whatever means it is transmitted. So nonetheless, we're thankful we got a Bible in our hand. But then he said, you got to have a Bible in your head. And growing up, I remember one of the disciplines that was very common in the church was that we would commit the scripture to memory. And we don't do that enough. You know, if you would memorize one verse of scripture a week, and that's not hard to do. And I'm not talking about one of these little Reader's Digest, you know, they take a verse and they just turn it into three words and, you know, that's, we memorize the verse. I know, but if you take a verse of scripture and you memorize one a week, in a year, you'd memorize 52 passages of scripture. In 2 years, you'd memorize 104 passages of scripture. In 3 years, 156 passages of scripture. Could you just imagine a lifetime of committing the Word of God to our memory? We need to have the Word of God not only in our hand, we need to have it in our head. And I want to pause there just a moment. When it comes to praying and praying effectively and powerfully, it is the Word that we have in our head that is a great resource and a great weapon in our prayer. Because there's so many times that I'm praying and I begin to pray, and then the Spirit of God just begins to prompt me, and the Word of God that I have stored up in my memory, that I have committed to memory, just begins to flow, and I'm able to pray the Word of God. And there's great value in that. So I want to challenge you, if you want to be powerful in your prayer, be powerful in the Word. Know the Word, because knowing the Word, you'll know the will of God, and that will give you the confidence and the boldness to be able to pray with greater certainty and greater faith, because you know you're not praying something that is contrary to what God wants. God has revealed to us what He wants, and it is in His Word. And sometimes we call them promises. Well, I got to tell you what the third Bible is. You got to have one in your hand, you got to have one in your head, but you got to have one in your heart. And that's when the Word goes beyond just the knowing, and it penetrates into what we are and what we do. And thy Word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against God. You see, there's scholars and academics, they've got the Word in their head, but it hadn't gone to their hearts. God help us. And there are people that maybe have studied the book from an academic perspective, and they have it memorized, and they know this and they know that, but it hasn't gone to their hearts. Well, we need it in our heads, but we also need it in our hearts. But here we were talking about the Bible as being one of the tools that God gives us, one of the weapons that God gives us to be able to be powerful in prayer. Friends, it is when we commit it to memory. Remember, the armor of God, the Lord said, take up the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The Psalms and other great prayers in the Bible that we can model or use as patterns for praying effectively. And that's one of the things that I learned years ago, that to be really powerful in prayer, one of the things that helps us is to immerse ourselves in the Psalms. So many of them are cries. Some of them are petitions and prayers, and that will help you. And so I want to encourage you, get in the Word in order to be powerful in prayer. That is what God calls us to do. promises to stand upon are found in His Word. Sometimes people use the word, we're going to claim His promise. Or sometimes we say, stand upon His Word. That's all very good and well. That's true. God is not offended. Listen to me. God is not offended when we take Him at His Word. If God didn't want to do something for us, He would have never promised it to us. So we don't have to be timid. We don't have to be, you know, kind of wishy-washy about praying something that God has in His Word told us He wants to do for us. If He has spoken it in His Word, and if He has promised it unto His people, God is not offended when He finds somebody who takes Him at His Word and stands upon His Word and prays His Word and believes His Word that it will come to pass. Many, many promises we have in the Bible. And when I've been reading here with you on noon prayer and at family altar at 7 o'clock, many times I will pause and point out to you promises that have been given. You know what the Bible tells us about those promises? In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, it says, "For as many as are the promises of God in Christ, in Him, they are yes. Therefore also through Him is our amen to the glory of God through us." So all God's promises are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. And so we don't need to be timid. We don't need to be bashful in our petitioning the God of heaven. We need to pray, and we need to pray His Word. And we need to claim the promise. We need to stand upon it. And you will not offend God. Trust me, you will not offend God. God rejoices. He's always rejoiced when He sees somebody that believes Him. Not just believes in Him, but believes Him. Some of you think that it's enough just to believe that there is a God, that God exists, but they don't really believe Him. They don't really take Him at His Word. But God rejoices. God, His heart is joyful when He finds somebody who not only believes that He exists, but actually believes what He has said. And that's praying the Word of God. Number two, pray in the Spirit. And I'm a big believer in this. We ought to be praying in the Spirit. And as a full gospel people, as a Pentecostal people, as a Spirit-filled people, friends, we have this great resource, especially in times like these, when we need to pray. And we don't often know how to pray as we should. But the Bible tells us in those moments, Romans 8:26, in the same way, the Spirit Himself helps our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we should. Have you ever been in one of those situations where you just can't even make heads or tails of it? You don't know where to begin? It's such a mess that you say, I don't know. I don't even know what to make of this. I don't know what's going on. And we may look at our world today and feel that way and say, I have no clue what's going on. Well, let me tell you something. Even in those moments, we can pray with confidence. We can pray with boldness, we can pray with authority, and we can pray with power because the Spirit helps our weakness. We don't know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He, the Holy Spirit, intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Isn't that wonderful? What a promise. You know, Paul prayed. He not only prayed in the Spirit, but he also prayed in understanding. And in the context of 1 Corinthians 14:15, he says, what is the outcome then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with my mind. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with my mind also. And the context of that, because some people have argued that praying in the Spirit is not praying in tongues. But if you look at the context of 1 Corinthians chapter 14, going back to chapter 12, 13 and 14, if you read it in its context, you will see that the Apostle Paul most definitely is talking about praying in tongues. He said, I pray in the Spirit and I pray with understanding. Jude verse 20 tells us, beloved, build yourselves up in the most holy faith. How? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Friends, I've said this many times, I'm going to say it again. I do not understand it, and I am not able to fully explain it. But let me tell you something. I am convinced by the testimony of Scripture and my own experience with the Lord. When you pray in the Spirit, when you pray in tongues, there is an infusion of power from heaven that will come and fill your heart and your life and strengthen you in ways, there's supernatural ways that you cannot even imagine. So I want to tell you right now, if you feel weary, if you feel weak, if you feel confused, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in tongues. And if you've not received, let's believe God together that He will baptize you so that you will have that full power to be able to pray. But praying in the Spirit, listen, and I'm thoroughly Pentecostal, but praying in the Spirit is not limited to praying in tongues. It sure, certainly includes that. But when we talk about praying in the Spirit and in the context we just read, that is part of it. But we're also talking about, in fact, Ephesians 6:18 tells us to pray with all petition. And it says, pray at all times in the Spirit. All of our praying should be in the Spirit of God. And sometimes people pray carnal prayers. Sometimes people pray selfish prayers. Sometimes people pray things that are not of God, that they're not in accordance with. All the prayer that we do ought to be in the Spirit. And that is that praying in the Spirit also means praying Spirit-directed prayers. When the Holy Spirit reveals and discloses things to us so that we can pray with greater effectiveness, revelation, knowledge comes. Many, many times I've been praying for somebody or I've been praying for a situation and I don't have all the information. But the Holy Spirit begins to prompt me. The Holy Spirit begins to reveal to me different things that are happening that I don't know, that nobody told me. Nobody came and whispered in my ear. It's not gossip. It's something that the Holy Spirit just says, this is what's going on. And sometimes I'm overwhelmed by it. I've told you some examples of times I've been in church and all of a sudden the Lord reveals something about somebody or something that's happening. And I'm just kind of overwhelmed with it. And I take it to the Lord in prayer and I'm able to pray. And how many times that has been confirmed later as something has come up. And I said, God, you showed me this. So when we pray in the Spirit, we are praying, and the Holy Spirit is able to direct us in our praying. Listen, and He's also able to reveal things to us that we could not humanly know. But the Holy Spirit Himself, because He is the Spirit of revelation and knowledge, He is able to impart unto us understanding of a situation that we could not have otherwise known. That's also praying in the Spirit. So I want to encourage you as you pray, let the Holy Spirit kind of lead you. Let the Holy Spirit kind of direct you. And you might start praying in a direction. I don't know what's going on. That the Holy Spirit maybe is leading you to pray for something. And you may be praying for somebody and they think their problem is here. And the Holy Spirit will show you, oh no, their problem is over here. And the Holy Spirit will show you to pray. And many times what happens is when God does stuff like that, we think we got to go tell everybody. No, tell it to Jesus. Tell it to the Lord. Pray. And if God gives you revelation about something, the best thing you can do is talk to Him about it, not go talk to some other brother or sister, and that becomes gossip, and that is not pleasing to the Lord. All right. Jesus said this, when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all truth, for He will not speak of His own initiative, but whatever He speaks, whatever He hears, He will speak. Here, I want you to notice this. He will disclose to you what is to come. Isn't that powerful? So praying in the Spirit, He will reveal to us what is yet to come. He will reveal it to us. All right, number three, praying effectively, praying powerfully. We have the Word, we have the Spirit, and then the Bible tells us that we are to pray in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Pray in the name of Jesus. Jesus said this to His disciples in John's Gospel chapter 14, beginning with verse 12. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to the Father. What happened when Jesus went to the Father? Well, He became our enthroned prayer partner, our heavenly intercessor, our mediator between God and man. And also, He poured forth the Holy Spirit, which we have now received. But then He goes on to say, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And so you see, the enthroned, exalted Christ, He is able to equip His people, empower His people, so that we will pray, and our prayers are not limited by time or space, but Jesus has been released through the resurrection and the glorification and the ascension. He has been released from the limitations of the human body, and He is able to go wherever it is that you and I pray and believe. That's why greater works, because now Jesus is not limited by geography. Jesus is not limited by physical things. That is a prayer that we can pray in the name of Jesus. Jesus went on to say in that same discourse in John's Gospel, chapter 16, verse 23, "In that day you'll not question me about anything. I truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, He will give it to you." He said, "Until now you have asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be made full." So we're to pray in the name of Jesus. We have a couple examples of how to do that effectively. You know, right after the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 3, Peter and John go to the temple through the gate called Beautiful. And there they find a lame beggar. And he's there, you know, with his hand outstretched. He'd been there for 40 years. His whole life, his hand outstretched. Somebody went and dumped him there. And there he sat begging. And the Bible tells us that Peter and John stood before him, and the man looked up at them expecting to receive alms. And Peter said to him, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, get up and walk." And the man was instantly healed. And he began to run through the temple shouting and praising God. He was like an original Pentecostal. See, it's in order when Jesus touches somebody for our hearts to be so full of joy that we run and shout and praise God and give Him glory. The religious crowd, like today, got angry just like they did back then. And they take Peter and John and they arrest them. But something very revealing happens as they are interrogating Peter and John. They took them before the rulers and the Caiaphas and the high priests, and they asked them this. They began to inquire of them. They put them in the center and they began to inquire of them. Listen to what they said. They said, "By what power or in what name have you done this?" Then the Bible tells us Peter, once again filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are on trial today for a benefit done to a sick man as to how this man has been made well, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified but God raised from the dead, by His name, this man stands here before you in perfect health." Friends, he went on to say that there is no salvation in any other name under heaven, because there is no other name under heaven been given among men by which we must be saved but the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. And we can pray with boldness and confidence and know that our prayer life will be effective because we pray in the authority of Christ. By what power? By what authority? By who? In whose name have you done this? And it is in the power and the authority of Jesus' name. Now, I pray in the name of Jesus is to pray in the authority that Christ has delegated unto His church. Listen to me and be very, very careful. Listen very, very good. This is not a formula. It is a declaration of authority based upon relationship. When we say in the name of Jesus, when we pray in the name of Jesus, when we do anything in the name of Jesus, it is not a formula, it is a declaration of authority based upon relationship. Get that very clear in your mind. Think about it like this. Few people can speak on my behalf. There's a few that can. Think about who could speak on my behalf that would be credible to you. Somebody came to you and said, "Pastor says this and thus," or "Pastor wants this or that." There are few people, if a stranger comes to you and said, "Well, Pastor said this and this," you would say, I don't think you've been authorized to speak on behalf of the pastor. You don't even know him. But my wife, how many knows if my wife came to you and said, "Pastor said this," or "Pastor asked for this," you would take it with credibility and you would say, well, I believe that it is right because of the authority, the relationship that they share. The authority has been delegated. The authority has been shared with her as well. My daughters, and some of you have caught on to this, every now and then somebody will come to me and say, you owe $25 for cookie dough. And I said, when did I order cookie dough? Well, your daughters ordered cookie dough. Well, you went to them and they signed up and they said, Dad will pay for it. And you believe them. You know why you believe them? Because of the relationship that we have. They're able to draw on my account, aren't they? They're able to speak on my behalf. They're able to make commitments for me. Now, if some other person said, oh yeah, I'm going to buy this and this and you go charge it to Pastor, you say, wait a minute here. Why would Pastor pay for what you're asking for? The closer the relationship, the stronger the authority one can exercise. It's not just about tacking on in the name of Jesus to any old carnal prayer prayed by any old carnal sinner and expecting that God is obligated to answer it. Friends, when we pray in the name of Jesus, it is because we are His. And He has given us the privilege of having Him delegate His authority to us so that we can exercise it here on earth and pray in the name of Jesus. I don't have a lot of time left, but in Acts chapter 19, something very curious happened. There was revival, and the Bible tells us that God was performing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. I always wonder when it says extraordinary miracles, how many think every miracle is extraordinary? I mean, I'd be happy to see miracles, but these weren't just miracles, regular old run-of-the-mill miracles. These were extraordinary miracles. Think about that. What would have to constitute an extraordinary miracle? Not run-of-the-mill miracles. It's just like when the Bible says of Abraham that he was exceedingly rich. And I thought, Lord, I'd be satisfied with just being rich. But he wasn't just rich, he was exceedingly rich. Well, these weren't just miracles, these were extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. And handkerchiefs and aprons were brought and carried from his body to the sick. See, the church has many times had to adjust for things like this. Diseases left them, the evil spirits went out. But listen to this, some of the Jewish exorcists went from place to place, attempted to name over those who had evil spirits in the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, I adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches, so that by their own admission, they don't know Jesus. We are here in the name of the Jesus whom Paul preaches. The sons of one Siva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. And the evil spirit answered and said to them, listen, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirits was leaped on them and subdued them, overpowered them, and they fled out of the house naked and wounded. See, the name of Jesus is not a magic formula. It is not to be used in vain. It is not to be tacked on to any old carnal prayer by any old carnal sinner. Because, friends, it is something that is delegated unto us who have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus, who have been bought with the price, those who are His, those who are of the household of faith, those who have been adopted as sons and daughters of God, those who know that God is our Father and Jesus is our elder brother, those who are seated together with Christ in the heavenly places, those of us, we have the privilege to be able to exercise the authority that comes in the name of Jesus. So pray in the name of the Lord. And that's the power. The devil's not afraid of us. The devil doesn't have to. But let me tell you something. The enemy knows, and the devil understands, that he was defeated at Calvary, and he was defeated 3 days later at the empty tomb. And he has been defeated all the way along. Jesus, I mean, even before that, Jesus, I mean, he was defeated when he was cast out of heaven. He was defeated when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. He was defeated when Jesus was tried in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus defeated the devil at Calvary. Jesus defeated the devil at the empty tomb. And so it is the power of Jesus that is released. And that's what the enemy has to obey and has to fear. And so that's what gives our prayer power, is that we walk with Him and we are His and He is ours. Pray in faith. Pray in faith. He said, well, of course, Pastor, pray in faith. You know, I'm on a crusade. You know that. I have said this. I'm going to keep saying it because something happened. I don't know where. I don't know how. I don't know who started it. But somewhere along the line in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, even in the Spirit-filled Pentecostal church, somewhere along the line, doubt became a virtue. Somewhere along the line, we have concluded very mistakenly that it is okay to doubt God, that it is okay to disbelieve His Word. Somewhere along the line, we have elevated doubt and unbelief to a Christian virtue. And I'm here today to tell you that the Word of God is clear. God honors faith. God has always sought a man and a woman who will believe Him. Never once in the testimony of Scripture with God's dealings with countless people do we ever find an occasion where God applauds somebody, rewards somebody, blesses somebody, or elevates somebody as an example because they doubted Him. In fact, this whole mess we're in right now started, didn't it? This whole mess we're in right now. Why are people dying of this disease? Why is this happening? Why is all... Let me tell you why. Because of doubt and unbelief. The enemy came and said to Adam and Eve, "Did God really say?" And that was the enemy's first... That was his first strategy to defeat a man, and it has been successful ever since. He will come, and there are some serpents behind pulpits that are standing there saying, "Well, did God really say this or that?" That's the serpent speaking. That's not God. A man of God proclaims the Word of God with conviction and with power and with authority. A true man of God does not go to the pulpit to try to infect the people with doubt and unbelief, causing you to think, "Well, did God really say that? Does God really mean this? Did God say what He meant?" As if God didn't have sense enough to say what He means and means what He says. I believe the Word of God is true. And if you're going to pray and expect to receive anything from God, listen to me, you got to pray in faith. You got to believe. You got to believe not only that God is, but you've got to believe that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. It is not enough just to believe that there is a higher power. You've got to believe that He will do what He said He will do. Jesus gave us a great example of this. In that final week, He cursed the fig tree. And the next day they came and the fig tree withered from the roots up. And Peter said, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree which you cursed is withered." And Jesus answered, said to them, "Have faith. Have faith in God." Now there are some people that have faith in faith. And that's wrong. We got to have faith in God. See, you can have a mountain of faith, but if you have it in a puny God, it is of no effect. But Jesus said, if you have faith even like the size of a mustard seed, but you have faith in a great, big, wonderful God, hallelujah, you will say to this mountain, "Be removed and be cast into the sea." The object of our faith is the power. So it's not that I have faith the size of a mountain. Oh, all you need is a mustard seed of faith. But if you have it placed in the right person, that is the one true living God, He will move mountains on your behalf. Jesus said, "Have faith in God." Then He said to this, "Truly I say to you, whoever says to the mountain, 'Be taken up, cast into the sea.'" Listen, listen, listen. Because there's some people who say, "Well, it's okay to doubt. God understands. It's okay to not believe Him. He understands. Just because you doubt doesn't mean you don't have faith." Oh, let me tell you, Jesus said, "Have faith." And then He said, "And does not doubt in his heart." We have got to dispel doubt. We have got to remove doubt and unbelief from our life. But believes that what He says is going to happen, it will be granted to him. Then He said, "Therefore I say to you, all things for which you pray and ask," listen, "believe that you have received them." Past tense. Believe that you have received them. Mark tells us that we believe that we have. When did you receive them? The moment you prayed for them. He said, "If you believe that you have received," listen, "they will be granted you." You say, "Well, I don't believe that." That's okay. You'll never have your prayers answered. You can live in. You can listen. You can go. You can be a Christian and die and go to heaven, and be an unbeliever. And there's a whole lot of them. They don't believe God heals. They don't believe God works miracles. They don't believe in speaking in tongues. They don't believe anything. And they're just put their faith in Christ, and they one day they're going to die and go to heaven. God bless them. But let me tell you something. The Lord calls us not to just have that kind of faith. He calls us to have the kind of faith that moves mountains. And the kind of faith that moves mountains is a faith that is rooted and grounded in the truth of God's word and does not doubt. Do not doubt in your heart. You know, James gave us a great example. We're nearing the end here. He said, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Trust me, I'm in that boat. Maybe I'm not alone. I hope I'm not alone. If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. He gives generously without reproaches, and he'll be given him. But in verse 6, James 1, he says, but he must ask in faith. And for all those out there who say, well, you can doubt and still have faith. But he must ask in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. And that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. In other words, people that pray without faith, that they pray in doubt, they don't get anything from God. God doesn't answer prayers offered in doubt. God answers prayers offered in faith. So I'm challenging you, I'm encouraging you today to believe God for miracles, to believe God for salvation, to believe God for supernatural things that happen in your life, because God responds to people who pray in faith. The Bible tells us that Abraham, he found favor with God because he believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. Everything we receive from God is through the basis of faith. In fact, the Bible goes on to say, without faith, it's impossible to please God. For those who come to God must believe that he is. But that's not enough. It's not just believing that he is, but that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. What does that mean? It's not just believing that he exists. It's not just believing that he is, but it is also believing that he will do what he said he would do. So let's believe God. And finally, I close to you today telling you the fifth and final thing I want to share with you. Pray in agreement with others of like precious faith. Pray in agreement with others of like precious faith. Now, I tell you this, I've shared this on other teachings as well. Sometimes you've got to be selective about who you pray with, pray in agreement with. Because as I mentioned before, some Christians are full of doubt and unbelief. Some Christians are negative and pessimistic. Some Christians spend their whole life operating in fear and not faith. The Bible tells us not to be unequally yoked, and certainly that applies to our marriage and the marital relationship. But let me tell you something, not all Christians are believers. And you have got to be very discerning about finding people to agree with you in prayer who have the like precious faith. If I go to somebody, they don't believe in divine healing, and I say, will you pray in agreement with me for God to heal me? They'll say, well, I don't believe that. And they're going to pray some kind of wishy-washy prayer. I remember one time I was invited to pray at a radio station, Christian radio station. But they branded our church as sensational, and they said this was in Arizona, that it was sensationalism. And let me tell you something, healing, the message of healing, the ministry of healing is sensational until you're the one that's sick. And then it's no longer sensational, it's good news. And so we were branded as sensational, and all the crazy stuff that they, because we prayed for the sick and we believed God to heal. And they invited me to pray, and they said, we're going to pray for the sick, and then they make sure time. But don't go praying that God will heal people, because we God doesn't do that anymore. The miracles ended with the last apostle, and don't go pray. I said, what do you want me to pray? What's left? Well, just pray that God will comfort them, that God will help them to accept their pain and their sickness, and that they'll just be okay with God, with death and all these things. Well, I don't want to pray in agreement with somebody like that. I want to find somebody that has like precious faith, somebody that believes that God can and that God will. Don't go with somebody who operates in fear. Go with somebody who operates in faith. And let me tell you, there are a lot of unbelieving church people, and there's even a lot of unbelieving Christians. I'm not questioning their salvation. I think one day they'll die just like the rest of us and go to heaven, and God bless them. But when they get to heaven, they're going to realize what all they missed. They're going to realize what all they could have had if they had believed God. But I want to believe God now. Don't look for someone who will encourage your faith and agree with you, not somebody who will try to discourage you because of their own failure. Sometimes the reason people don't have faith is because their own failures. And they're trying to infect you with that negativity because of what has happened in their lives. All right, we close Matthew 18:19. Jesus said, if two of you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. Praise the Lord. So we learned today a number of things. We learned that we have been thoroughly equipped to be priests unto God and to be powerful in prayer. How? Pray the Word. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in the name of Jesus. Pray in faith. And finally, pray in agreement. So let's pray. Let's pray in agreement right now that God is going to visit us, that we're going to have revival, that people are going to be saved and healed and delivered and filled with the Holy Ghost. And even during this time of that we are not able to be physically together, God's Word is not bound. God's Word is not locked up. The Word of God and the Spirit of God are moving. And so let's pray. Let's pray in agreement right now. Father, we come before you today. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your Word, that in times like these, God, we become even more aware of how powerful and living and relevant your Word is to every generation. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word shall never pass away. It is alive and sharper than a two-edged sword, and it's piercing unto dividing of soul and spirit. God, we thank you today for your Word. We thank you, Lord God, that it gives us the knowledge we need to be able to take our place in the army of the Lord as well-equipped soldiers ready to do spiritual battle against the forces of darkness, not with timidity, not with fear, not with doubt, not with unbelief, but in full confidence of faith, knowing that you are with us. And that you will confirm your Word, and you will perform what you have said you would do. So God, we're praying and believing that not only tonight, we're praying for miracles on Friday night, healings to take place all across the country and even around the world as people watch the broadcast. We're praying, God, that you will, the Holy Spirit, the heavens will open up and the Spirit of the living God will come down on every living room and every home and every heart, that fathers will lay hands on their children and they shall receive the baptism in the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues, that your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, Lord, that you will do a great and mighty work. God, we thank you today, for we know, Lord God, we are fully convinced, fully persuaded that you hear us and that you will respond to the cries of your people. God, we give you thanks and we pray all this, yes, because we are sons and daughters of God. We pray all this because we've been adopted into the family. We pray all this because God is our Father, Jesus is our elder brother. We pray all this today in the name, most precious and powerful, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We've enjoyed our time together in the Word. I look forward to seeing you at Family Altar and Noon Intercession. And of course, do not miss for anything in the world. There's nothing in the world right now to entice us. But let us not miss our Good Friday revival service, healing service. You are going to be blessed, and I'm praying that miracles are going to happen and that you're going to receive that miracle. Amen? Well, God bless you. I love you. God loves you. And friends, if anything, the Word of God has confirmed to us once again, we are more than overcomers in Christ Jesus.
Well, thank you again for joining us here at Dallas First Assembly online on Facebook or YouTube, wherever you have decided to join us. Let me remind you to go ahead and subscribe. Go ahead and like our page so that you don't miss any of the services that we have throughout the week. Our Sunday service, our Wednesday night service, our live prayer times that we have going on, as well as to just stay connected with any other special moments like this weekend that we have, Friday and Saturday and Sunday night special services, that you can join us at 7 o'clock each night to hear a word from God on this Easter weekend. Well, thank you all for continuing to be faithful in your giving, your tithes and your offerings and to missions. And let me go ahead and remind you that you can go to our website, d1ag.org, or you can mail in your tithes and offerings to 11000 East Northwest Highway, Dallas, Texas, 75238. To continue your giving. Have a blessed night.